Hello, this is Mike at GameFromScratch, and welcome to another episode of the Gamedev Toolbox, a look at the tools that are essential for the world of game development. Today we're going to look at somewhere between an artist and a programmer tool that is responsible for packing sprites together into a single or multiple large image files, generally with some kind of a dictionary that goes with that to describe where things are located. Now, it's a very common practice in the world of game development. Quite often you might work with your individual assets as individual files, but when it comes time to deploy, for a number of reasons, one of the biggest of which is performance, both for loading speeds and for graphics drawing speed, it's convenient to have all your like-minded textures located in a single load. It's faster to load one 1024 by 1024 file than it is, God, don't make me do the math, but say 26 or 32 by 32 files, for example. So it's common to pack all these files together into a single one. Now, another major part is texture switching on the graphics card is an expensive process. So if you have a lot of like-minded animation and you can pack it all in the same individual texture, it is going to perform better. Now, the package we're looking at today is called Texturepacker. I'm only going to look at pretty much the basics of its functionality. You can explore in more depth on your own. There is a basic version, which is not time limited in any way, but it has a little bit of stripped down functionality. And there is a full-blown version, which costs money. I should actually have the price in advance, but I do not. Just a sec. The price is $55 Canadian, or probably 26 cents US. You can use it in the base form. Don't worry. The majority of what I'm going to show today is available in the base package. But it's very much easily worth the money if this is something you're doing on a regular basis. Now, another aspect I'm not covering today is a lot of the functionality we're going to show with the GUI is also available as command line tools. So if you want to build this as part of your build system, you can. Invoke it from command line, pass in the parameters as you wish, and you get generally the same end result. So there is a command line based version of everything we're about to see, and I'm not going to cover it. So without further ado, let's jump right into Texturepacker. Here is the UI, like so. Very simple, very clean, very easy to work with. Now the first things first, we're gonna need some textures to come in here. And here, for example, is a package. It's free sprites that are available online. I forget the exact source I got them from, but it's a set of World War II airplane sprites. And here's three types of the Junkers 87 B-2 aircraft. And each one in turn has three frames of animation. Now to bring these files in, very simple. Just, oops, don't do that. Bring in, drag, drop. Now, as you add more, they will be arranged. So you can see the frames coming in down this way, and they're being collected here and automatically resized by Texturepacker. Now, this is overkill. There's a much simpler way of doing it, and it'll probably result in cleaner overall results. So we'll just take the whole directory structure that our sprites are coming from. Like so. And you'll see it automatically arranged all three sets. They correspond over here, and it nicely preserves the folders that we are working with. Like so. So we come into our animation, see, collects the first frame, second frame, third frame, or as I selected over here, the corresponding choice is picked over there, or I can multi-select, and you can see the end result. So we can group these things together. It's nicely organized. It brings in and preserves the underlying folder structure that you have and are working with. And then the majority of what it's doing is generating this collection here. It's creating this output or multiple files of output depending on how you set things up. Now, the key part is picking which game engine you're working with. And Texturepacker has out of the box support for just about all of them. So here, for example, we've got Cocos 2DX is the default selector, the one I most recently used. But you can see we can do a spreadsheet only, which is basically just the image file, which in many cases is all you need, especially if you're not doing anything really advanced. If you're not trying to pack the maximum amount of space in as possible, you're just trying to create a grid of textures, we could do a sprite sheet only, no problem here. Let's go ahead and do that. So let's, instead of saying any size here, we want to go down here and say power of two. Quite often a requirement of game engines. The next thing you notice is it rotated this one. And that's going to need some kind of a definition file in order to get that out. So we can go ahead and turn their algorithm off to basic. Now it's just a straight flat grid. And we can also influence the dimensions that we want. So we could say the max size in the one direction is 1024. And you see, it's just gonna resize and recreate it as we go. Now, another thing that's going on here is it's automatically trimming down to the pixel level. We can also turn that off if we wish to keep it exactly as it was. And now you see, we're basically just creating a grid of sprites in a single sheet. We can go ahead and you'll find what I just did. All of what I've just done is completely supported within the basic version. So if you just want to create these kind of grids, no problem, out of the box. It's when you start getting into these advanced settings, you know, your algorithms for changing things up, all that, that's all in the upgrade version. But just doing what we just did, I think the only thing you need to turn off is the ping optimizations. And then it's a matter of just exporting it out. So we can publish out our sprite sheet, and we'll do my sprite sheet. We'll dump that out to the desktop and save it. And you see, it did it, it results, print it out, and boom. And then here is your sprite sheet. And that's it. That's really all that you have to do to get a very basic sprite sheet out of Texturepacker. Now we're gonna start looking at the slightly more advanced functionality. And again, some of this is going to require the full version to use. And it's mostly just stuff that we just turned off. Now for one, we probably would want to do something other than just a general sprite sheet. And you can see here, the various game engines that are supported is pretty extensive. So you got Unity, Cocos 2D, 2DX, Swift, Corona, Sparrow, Easel.js, Gitteros, Panda, Phaser as JSON array and JSON hash array, etc., etc. So you know what? Let's go ahead and do Phaser as a JSON array. You'll see the end result of doing so. So go ahead. And a lot of times there's also some corresponding code or an example on CodeAndWeb site of how to integrate the results with your game engine of choice if there's any additional requirements. But as you can see, majority of the game engines you would probably want to use are in there. Plus, if you don't have what you want, there's either custom or you can do a generic XML or generic JSON definition file and easily integrate it with your code. So now let's go ahead. So we picked Phaser with JSON array and do a convert. And it's kind of undone our settings, so it's going back to what the default settings are for this kind of export. And the values available here will change based on the engine you just selected. So now we're going to pick the name of the data file that's going to be exported. So I think I called it my sprite sheet. We'll go with my sprite sheet.json. So now it's going to also be generating a file to go with this. And now let's go with a little bit more advanced option here. We'll go back to 20 by 48. So, but now instead, we'll let it do some optimization. We could also have it come in here and do, you can see there's a number of different texturing formats now. Only the ones that are supported by the underlying game engine that you selected are going to be shown. But there's a number we could use here. For example, PVR can result in some very serious levels of optimization there. Or we could just drag this guy across and get some slightly better file sizes as a result. Next up, we're going to go here, size constraints. Like I said, you can do power of two or not. Increasingly, power of two is not as important as it used to be, but still for sometimes, especially older OpenGL ES1, for example, power of two is straight out a requirement. And somewhat, you're gonna find that a little bit more with the WebGL world if you're exporting out to it. Now we can do our algorithm. We'll go with max rects. Nope, multi-pack is turned off. And instead of trimming, yeah, we'll trim. So this will flush them down. Actually, you know what? Phasers is not a great demonstration of what it can do here, because we can also have it can rotate them, trim them down, pack them in as tightly as possible. But again, the actual version the engine you choose is going to limit down what can be applied to it. So you can have it trim or not trim. And trimming would not work if you're working on just a space size. So if you're depending on each being 32 by 32 pixels, for example, you want trimming set to none. But if you're going to be using a definition file, you're allowed to trim it, and it will just pack it down to just the pixels. So save a lot of, pull out the white space and pack as much into that texture as possible. And now let's just go ahead and publish that guy out. Now you see the same basic result. We're going to have a different size sprite sheet. Our sprite sheet is now like this instead of the grid. But we also have this guy. And this is the definition file that will be, this is the definition file that will be loaded by Phaser. This is a JSON file it'll bring in, so it will just know how to deal with these sprites. You see that everything's going to be keyed by name. Its location is available, whether it's rotated, trimmed, where it's located, etc., all packed in there. So your game engine knows how to best load these files for you. And it makes the process very, very simple from your end. Now, if you go to GameFromScratch.com, I actually have a couple of tutorials on working with Texturepacker already. And you'll see it works somewhat flawlessly. But that's it. That's all I'm going to cover for today. Now, once again, there's a little bit more to it. If I picked a different game engine, we could have seen a lot more results here. It could have rotated and really jammed in the textures. There's some more compression options out there, etc. But the basic premise is here, and a lot of what we just saw is available in the base version, which you can get started with for absolutely no price. So once again, that's Texturepacker from CodeAndWeb. It's a very focused tool, but does what you need, how you need it, in a very clean and efficient manner. So if you need to pack your sprites together, definitely check this guy out. Hope you enjoyed that. See y'all later.